yeah, let's get started. So this presentation is going to be split into different parts. So the first one, we are going to have a look at how the heap balancing design is supposed to be working right now on TQ. Notice I said supposed to be working. And then we'll have a look at several ideas on how to improve it. So just one question, how many here did read the blog about heap balancing? Could you raise your hands? Yeah. Okay, that's good. That means most of you already know most of the stuff that's going here. You most likely vented the rage out already by kicking your sister in the face. So that's okay. I mean, I'm most likely not to get some blunt object in my face right now. Excellent. So let's get started. First, let's have a look how it's supposed to work, how we in game design are supposed to sort shapes in general, and how all of this shit is supposed to work. Well, I mean, we find variables. Find variables, how to differentiate the shapes. And I mean, of course, you do know about them, so it's going maybe to be a little too obvious right now, but you need it to understand the second part. The first variable we use is size. And as your girlfriend most likely told you, size does matter for shape balancing. So size impacts a lot of things. It impacts on which kind of models you can fit on your shape. It impacts how speedy your shape is going to be. It impacts the role. It impacts where you want to be on the battlefield. So when you start in here, you start with a small category, like frigates and destroyers. And then you move on as you get more experience and more skills. You move on into the biggest class, like medium, with like cruisers and battle cruisers, and then you move into battleships. And finally, we have our beloved capital ships. So size has a certain number of consequences. First of which is experience. I mean, you start at the frigate category as a new player, and as you move on with time, you're going to the capital one. Of course, that's only a recommendation. You are free not to choose recommendation, but if you don't, then you're most likely to end up as a kill mail in low sec while trying to smart bomb gates in a Titan, for example. So, again, if you follow this, then replacement. Not only replacement is cost, but it's also the general ease to replace this. I mean, replacing a frigate fitting is really quickly, but if you want to just have a look at the capital and replace fittings and make sure maintenance is working, it's just a lot more clumsy. Then we have the purpose. The purpose is just like, since smaller ships are supposedly smaller, and you can use them for like hit and run tactics, just like fast ganks, whereas on the other side of the ladder for capitals, it's more of like static fleet fight with just imposing ships, just soaking damage. And then, I mean, the attributes, it's just basically what I said right now between the two. So you can see fast, agile, flighty, fleeting for frigates, and slow, resilient, and imposing for capitals. The second variable we have is tech. So tech, you know it, when you start the game with tech one. Tech one is the first reference you get used to. I mean, tech one chips are supposed to be the most basic ones. And then as you just go and train into the game, you have access to like faction ships, which are just plain improvements over tech one. You have tech two ships, which are supposed to be specializations. And you have tech three, which are supposed to be generalization over tech one. So the question you may ask yourself right now is, why do we have a small square for tech one? And why do we have like huge blobs for the tech? Well, that's because of our own shortcomings. That's because we ourselves don't know exactly where each blob is supposed to be. I mean, is that tech two specialization supposed to be overstepping faction or getting improvement? Is tech three supposed to be on par with tech two? How exactly in percentage? We don't know exactly. And that's why we wanted this project as well, to just define this as you will see it in the next slide. So the second is tech. And how does it translate into like ship progression? Again, in blue here, you have like the tech one ships for AMR, like you start with AMR frigates, AMR cruiser, AMR battleships, capitals, and then at the bottom you have the industrial line. And you have the two generic skills with destroyers and battle cruisers. Then you move here, the navy ships in green. The faction, the pirate ships, are just a bit weird because you need, for example, for the Blood Raider, you need AMR battleship and Minamata battleship. for the Balgorn, for example. And then you have Tech 2, which is just like this huge big mac of shit inside the blue lines. Just like, yeah, okay, I want to go into AVS or ship, so where do I go for the follow the puzzle? And then in red, you have like the tech free ship. Okay. Then the next variable is tier. Tier for tech one, manufacturer for tech two, and subsystem for tech three. But I ran out of the space on the presentation, so I just marked tiers. So you start with a rookie ship, tier one, for forget. And then, as time passes, you start going into second tier, for forget. I'm a forget level two. You move into tier three. You can see that now you get access to the slicer, the Navy variation. Then you have access to destroyers. You can move into the wonderful Auguror that everyone here must use. Then you move into the tier two, tier three, and then, okay, the Omen Navy issue is not really tier four, but it just was nice looking, so I put it there. Then, I mean, you got a picture. You got a picture with the battlecruiser, same thing, with the battleships, same thing. Capitals are a bit of an exception. Hopefully, we don't have tiers for them, because otherwise, like, tier two, Titan, that will be a bit over the top. So that's for tech one ships. Tiers is a progression metric that we use right now. I mean, in the same class, the higher your tier, the most likely you are going to have more slots, the more hit points you are going to have, and so on. So as you train, for example, the Armored Cruiser skill, you are going to move from the Auguror to then the Arbitrator, and then the Omen, and then Mala, and every time you can see a slot progression, you're getting the shape and hit points. Okay, that's for tech one. Tech two, we have manufacturers. So what are manufacturers? They're just specialization that you apply to a tech one hull to get what you wanted with it. So if you take a Mala, you apply a black camo to it, a black sexy camo to it, you add missiles, and ta-da, you have a Kanit ship. So here you can see Khartoum, I'm not even sure how you pronounce that in the first place, but okay, then you move into Kanit ships, and then Vizia. And that's how Tech 2 ships are just sorted with each other. And finally, we have like Tech 3. Tech 3 ship is just like subsystems in general, so you just like several subsystems, you just warp on into your ship and you get the legend. Okay. So based from all of that, we had just a small game running on this. How many ships do we estimate to be used right now? I mean, we had a look at slots, hit points, we had a look at popularity of ships as well. And which kind of ships are used when are in the game, which kind of ships feel need to be improved, and which kind are a bit on the verge of just being completely crap. So let's have a look. That's a chart for all the ships in the game, except a few exceptions with like all ships. We don't have pirate ships as well. It's just like tech one, tech two, tech three, and the Navy ships for the four main factions. So first, let's have a look at the ships we like. I mean, we think are okay. So that's approximately half of them. So yeah, half of them being okay. I mean, you still have some exceptions, but it's still going on. Then in yellow, we have ships that are causing issues, but still work somehow. I mean, you have Titans at the hand. Yeah, they work, but they're causing still some issues that we need to get to. And finally, ships that are just, they're not happy with. And yeah, I mean, it's a bit shameful when you look at this. And the first ship that are completely horrible are the frigates. So imagine you are a rookie player, you just join EVE Online. Welcome to EVE Online. It's a sandbox. Every ship is supposed to be useful. But you should train for battle cruisers because frigates and cruisers are crap. It's, yeah, it's not a messaging we are, you know, proud of. So we would like to change that. Half of the ships are just crap. I mean, half. It's just like we gave you a bottle of beer, a glass of beer, and we replaced half of it with motor oil. Just like, enjoy your beer, guys. It's the same thing here. I mean, seriously, when you join the game and you see that, when we saw that, it's just like, okay, we need to do something about that. And that's why we are moving to the next part, in the future direction. Again, that's not something we are going to implement tomorrow. something that we want in the next month. We want to have a discussion with you. We can't promise it's going to be perfect, but we can promise, and it definitely will, that we want to have feedback with you. So why do we want to bring that? First, let's clarify tech a bit, because, I mean, as you saw before, you have like these huge blobs, and you don't know how they exactly overlap. So let's have a look again. Tech one, improvements, specialization, and generalization later on each side. And then you move on. Navy is just a plain improvement over tech one. So you've just like Omen and Navy Oven, you just gain extra shit on top of it. Pilot is just stacking up on top of that. Most of the time, I mean, you have specializations that are a bit weird regarding Pirate, but it's okay. It's okay. We can make do with it. Then Tech 2, at the moment, is we think it's supposed to be between Pirate and Navy regarding the sense of improvement power. So, and lastly, we have Tech 3. Tech 3 is supposed to be less efficient at Tech 2 at a given role. So, I mean, I will leave some time for you to just process that. So, so for example, if we take command ships with the gang links, and we take like tech three ships with the same gang links, if we follow this, that means that the command ships with gang links are supposed to give more bonuses than tech three with the gang links, which is not the case right now. But tech three ships with the gang links maybe are supposed to be more general. So maybe instead of giving like one or two, they should give like three bonuses to gang links, whereas command ships just give like one or two, but higher. So that way, you don't have this weird overlap we are right now. And it's also why we have issues with just like the Nighthawk, the Tengu, and the Drake being doing kind of the same thing, but just with a different price tag attached to it. So yeah, we definitely want to sort that out, to have a look on how we can make ships less redundant. That means that tech three ships, we are aiming to make them more different regarding the other variations. That means we're going to find new models for them to fit on. I mean, I think there is a model presentation later today. I mean, remind me if I'm wrong, because I have the memory of a turnip. But yeah, we are supposed to have like a model presentation, and possibly we could tie the tech three ships to some of these models. Again, work in progress, don't scream yet. Next, skill and progression changes. So this is one I need to be very careful about the messaging, because yeah, it created some feedback on the forum, only 90 pages on the dev blog. So yeah, before we start, no matter what we do, even when we do that, you could still fly the ships you could fly before. So that's how you just train for ships right now. So you can see you have like racial skills for tech one, you have like armor frigate, armor cruiser, armor battleship. Then you have like generic skills like destroyers and battle cruisers, and then you have like all the tech two skill in the middle. So there are several things we don't like about that. The first one is that we are always telling our new players, if you want to be on a competitive level with our veterans, you need to specialize, 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 and you'll be able to go into fight easier, more easily. But, the main problem is that if you look at, for example, fleet command ship and field command ships, in order for you to specialize into them, you need racial cruiser at 5, you need battle cruiser at 5, and then you need either logistics or AV assault at 4, and I'm not even counting the leadership requirements here. So what we would like is just like a new player or any kind of player that want to specialize into command ships. Just make it consistent with the other. You only need battlecruiser at 5 and the proper tech 2 skill. You don't need this weird combination of racial cruiser at 5 and so on, because that's coming from the generic skill. So what we want to do is just split the generic destroyer and battlecruiser skill into 4. So so even if we do that, again, I want to make it clear, we make sure to reimbursement. It's going to be a pain in the ass, but we need to do it so you can still fly the ships you could before. The second issue, you can see the difference before and after, is that it's not really consistent to have like generic skills like destroyers and battlecruisers, and then racial skills like armor cruiser and battleship. So we want to make it consistent all the way by having racial skills all the way. To this, you could say, yeah, okay, yeah, but one, don't you have like make it consistent by having generic skills all the way? So for example, you could start with frigate, you remove Amar, you just like one variation, and then you move it to destroyer, and then to cruiser. To this, the main answer is then that it would be too easy for you to just train every single ship, because the main issue you have like with battle cruisers right now is that as long as you have the cruiser requirement to 3, you can unlock 12 ships by training battle cruiser. So if you train battle cruiser at 5, and you have like Amar cruiser at 3 and Kalari cruiser at 3, you can unlock 6 ships for one skill, which we believe is too much right now. The second, you can see the difference here next to the previous and the new one, is that we cut some Tech 2 requirements. So for example, if you look at ASO ships and AV ASO ships, you don't have a, damn it, you don't have a dependency anymore. Same for recons and covert ops. So why is that? Is that because, again, I'm a player. I want to specialize in a ship I like. For example, recon ships. I like to just like come and unclock my pilgrim and just like rape some people, some haulers or whatever, some miners. And to do that, I still have to, at the moment, train and specialize into a ship I'm not interested at all, covert ops. And it's even worse with like field command ship, because if I want to train for an absolution, I have to train for the AV ASO ship and then for the ASO ship as well requirements before I can specialize into the command ship I like. That's why you want to do that. Also, some comments that came out from the blog is that we are making capital ships a little too easy to train for, which is a very good comment. And to this, again, reducing the battleship skill to 4 was to make it consistent, but there is nothing preventing us from increasing the other requirements to make like the training time to get the capitals the same before and after the change. So don't panic. The next stuff we wanted to do is just, these are late traps here, it was to just like introduce ship lines. So you may ask yourself, what the fuck are ship lines and what is this madman talking about? Well, ship lines are supposed to remove tiers, or what you call tiricide or tiricid. Excuse my accent, I just can't pronounce it right. But tiers at the moment, we are not happy with them. We are not happy with them because, as I said before, tiers are affecting the slots, are affecting the hit points you get. And in a sandbox game, in a sandbox environment, where we are trying to promote that each ship has a specific role and a specific purpose in the battleship, in theory, having a system that artificially makes ships better than others is just paradoxical to that purpose. So we want to remove tiers, flush them out down the toilet, Dwayne, and have ship lines instead. So again, ship lines name and icons are again work in progress, so don't scream. The first one we wanted is just like the combat line. So what are combat ships? It's mainly ships that go on the front line and take most of the damage. I mean, to the blog, we compared that to like 18th century ship of the line, and that's quite a good comparison. It's just like ships you want at the core of the battlefield that forms the main bulk of your fleet. Then you will have attack ships. Attack ships are just like mainly damage ships, just like you can be compared with just like cavalry ships. You can see the icon is mainly looking like a virtual E-pin because it's damage. Bad joke. Comparisons. So for example, if you look at attack ships that you could have in HIV after the change, would be for example an Armageddon, a Megatron. These are supposed to be ships that just come at the back and smash you in the face. Then, like bombardment ships, mainly this is missile ships, just like the Raven, for example, is a very good representation of that. Then we have like support ships, like logistic ships or like recon ships, are a very good example of that. And finally, we have industrials, like haulers and haul ships and all this stuff. So from this, you could introduce new skills tied to this. And you could have specializations as well to better refine each line. So for example, if you go into combat ships could be like the Abaddon, the Hyperion, or the the Apocalypse. So here you have two specializations between, for example, sniping ships and just like armor soaking, or just more of a tanking ship. I don't like this term much, but okay, we have to use it right now. And the difference would be like, for example, the Apocalypse is mainly sniping, same for the Rock, and then the Abaddon would just be more of a tanky and tank and spark ship. Then you move into attack ships, you have like two specializations, you could have turrets, and you could have drones. So for example, Dominix could be an attack ship, but the Megatron also could be an attack ship. The difference is that one just relies more on the drones than the other. Bombardment ship. So here, you like two specializations we could have is just like, we could have long range. Okay, I know, we know that cruise missiles need to be looked into, so don't smile when I'm saying long range with missiles, because we know. But part of the change is to make that useful as well, is that the first specialization, again, is just like making long range specialization for hitting targets that are the same size or bigger than you. And the second one could be like close range damage for targets that are same size or smaller than you. So for example, if you wanted to have a look at a Typhoon or revamp it next to the Raven could be like long range damage, while the Typhoon could be like close range damage for smaller targets, for example. Again, not set in stone. Support ships. I have like two specializations again. You have disruption, just like the Falcon and the Rook and like recon ships. And then you have assistance, just like logistic ships. And finally, on the serials, like target ships, you have like hauler with industrials, and you have like mining ships with like ore ships. And then when we have that, it helps because we have a general guideline on how to balance the ships. It's a lot more flexible than having the tiers, because the tiers, again, force you to have a certain number of slots for each class. So if we go into cruiser, you need this amount of slots, and you can't deviate from that, because otherwise you're not really in the same tier. The tiers are also causing problems with price balancing in general, because higher tiers are supposed to be more expensive. And that was something that was a bit annoying for like when we have a look at the tier 3 battlecruisers, for example, because they were supposed to fit a price tag between the tier 2 battlecruisers and the tier 1 battleships. And it was like, okay, 50, 60, it was a bit of an auction inside TCP. How much do you want? 50, 55. So yeah. So next to this, we can have general idea on how they fit to each other. Again, this is not fixed. You could see that, for example, the combat ships are very good offense and defense, but very poor mobility. You could see that attack ships have like a very good mobility and a good offense, but their defense is not that great, and so on. I mean, you can read for yourselves here. So yeah, that's how we would like, possibly, to have a look into this. So now, let's have a look at the change and how it's going to impact the ship tree. And here I'm very happy because I can finally show my big badass picture I showed on the blog, and which was quite too big actually, and here it doesn't matter because it's just fitting. So that's the tree again of all the ships in Heave as they are in the game right now. With the changes, it becomes that. So I'm going to go forth and back several times to explain what we mean here. Then again, before, for the tech 2 ships, you had like all these inter-class dependencies, for example, between recons and cover hops and heavy assault and assault. This goes away with the new. You can see something as well in the new one is, can you see it actually? Yeah, you can. Is that at the bottom right corner, we now have the ships sorted by ship line instead of having the tiers with the numbers at the top. So that helps. So some example on how this could help the balancing in general. Let's have a look at the prophecy. Who here is using the prophecy except as bait? Yeah, that's what I thought. Nobody? No, okay. The prophecy could become, with this change, a support ship. A support ship, what does that mean? That all of a sudden, your prophecy that was like a bit of a useless tanking ship except for bait, now it's becoming a drone ship, more like an oversized arbitrator. And it's part of the support line. So you start with a support line. I can't remember the frigate, the tech one frigate that you support on. Nobody uses it anyway. Who the fuck remembered its name? Anyway, you start with a frigate. Is it the Tormentor or the. I can't remember. Anyway, you start with a frigate, and then you move into the arbitrator, and then you have the prophecy. A prophecy that could just use tracking disruptors and drones. And then you could even have a battleship with this. Just with this line of having support, tracking disruptors, and drones in general. What does it help as well is that the Mala, who's using the Mala? Yeah, okay, same thing. The Mala could be on the combat cheat line. So what will it do for it is that it will be a mini Abaddon. So you could have, like, for example, keep the resistance bonus and have a damage bonus now on. Have a look at the capacitor, and now it's a ship that's a lot more useful. With this, also, is that since all the cruisers are on the same pool of slots, it allows us to have a look and give fittings and slots to ships that really need them. The Omen, for example, ever tried fitting anything on the Omen? Good luck. But with this, we could give Omen some love. So some more explanations. I guess most of you have noticed that some of the Tech 2 ships are changing manufacturers. That is because manufacturers are supposed to be specialized at like one or two things. But we have some inconsistencies right now in the game. We're getting some of them. So for example, the Zealot, if I go back, the Zealot, I think it's a Khartoum ship. Yeah, Khartoum. And now it's a Vizlam, and now it's removed to Khartoum, because Khartoum is supposed to be like this heavy damage, whereas in the new plan, Vizlam is more of a support. So it makes little sense for a ship like the Zealot, which is supposed to be main damage, to still be in a manufacturing line that is not related to it. That means, like, yeah, subships which are not cannied will move away from the cannied line, and so on. I mean, I can't go over all the changes right now. So yeah, that's basically about it. I'm not sure where I am on time, but I guess you all have questions right now. Do we know the time? Time 6, okay, I guess we have time for some questions, actually. Just let me grab the mic. So yeah, does anybody have questions here? Thank you. 30
minutes. 30? 30. Yeah, 30.
Okay.
Actually, if this is a very important constituent issue that people have been asking me about for years, if you're changing the manufacturer on the Zealot, does that mean that it's finally going to get a proper red paint job?
Yes. The point, changing. You got lucky because we almost changed the cool black camo on the Damnation as well. But yeah, let's not do that right now. Otherwise, just hot creel will be terrible. So yeah. Any other question?
This is a more general one about supercarriers and Titans and stuff. What are you actually going to do to counter those in terms of giving a hard counter that can also be countered? I mean, there was discussion yesterday in the Black Ops about, you know, the Black Ops, you know, the Widow can jam them and stuff. One of the ideas I've actually been discussing with people is giving the electronic attack frigates an actual role so they can actually punch through. I mean, they're supposed to be a specialized one. At the moment, they're paper thin. No one flies them except for Alliance tournament. Has there been any consideration to giving them a role, and that role being they can actually punch through super capital E-War immunity?
Okay, allow me to just sum up your question first, because I didn't understood all of it. You're talking about Black Ops and how useless they were and how better you want them to be.
No, it was one of what was suggested yesterday that, you know, for instance, the Widow could be a counter to a Titan, but the problem is it's got too much tank. So the question is something that's counterable would be an electronic attack frigate, because, you know, they're paper thin, one bomb run and they're off the field. Has somebody actually looked at giving the electronic attack frigate an actual role?
Yes. Electronic attack frigates are quite high on the list. Same for Black Ops, because, I mean, we had a look at ships flown right now on TQ. And if you compare Black Ops with Titans in number of, like, how many pilots are using them, there are more pilots flying Titans than Black Ops. So yeah, we do know there is a problem about them. Regarding fixing black ops in general, I guess, I mean, as we said during the black ops presentation yesterday, it's all about finding a role for them, because at the moment, I don't know what they're supposed to be. They're just like identity crisis. They're supposed to be like attack ships that just are into the, in the fight, or they're more supposed to be like support ships to just move you around. Maybe could have like split that into two different ships and then boost each ship to just do its role properly. So for example, we could have like a battleship line that does ACM and dampening, just like you have recons, and then you could boost Black Ops to just be better at having these gangs moving along by having a lower fuel consumption and so on. Again, that's just a brain fart at the moment. Any other question, please?
Hello. There is a question. Why from all Tech 2 ships there is no combat specialization at all?
Excuse me, there is no?
Why from all Tech 2 ships there is no combat specialization? They are bombardment or attack ship, but not combat one. Only from Tech 1 ship is combat specialization.
I mean, that's supposed to be combat specialization here in Tech 2. It's just like Tech 2, as I said, is mainly focused with manufacturers. So the ship lines are mainly for T1 ships. And the Tech 2 are more focused on the manufacturer, so you still have combat. For example, the, yeah, okay. Yeah, that's a good question, actually, because because now I think about it, yeah. You could say, for example, the Absolution is more of a combat ship regarding these lines than the Zealot, because it's supposed to be more resilient, but that's a good point. That's a good point. Definitely, that's something we need to take out when we do the ship line moving. God damn it, there's a wires everywhere. Anyway, does that answer your question? Or am I just blubbering one? Okay, that's, okay, cool.
Hi. You were talking about ship lines and how they were all in line, but curious thing is, with it being, you know, with a lot of modules, so you can specify and customize each and every ship, would you also be implementing sort of similar fixes for the modules that will go with the ships? Also, I noticed that Titan is support for the supporting fleet.
I'm not sure I understood the question. Excuse me, but with your accent and...
The modules,
yes.
Will they also be balanced according to the ships they go on to?
Because you mean the Tech 2 mods for like, that go on specialized ships, right? Or are you just talking about modules in general?
Just like generally modules, say tracking enhancers, for example, will they be fixed to sort of benefit more of the specific class, rather than, you know, being able to be put on any ship and made it
okay.
into a different
okay, okay.
kind of ship?
The point with module at the moment is that they're supposed to be like generic. I mean, then we don't want to restrict too much on what you can do with any kind of setup, because it's just then killing the idea of having creative setups coming out of nowhere. Any kind of specialized module are more mainly tied to Tech 2 and possibly Tech 3 when you go to that. So no, at the moment, I mean, you have like some module rebalancing on our list, quite a few, but we are not planning on making them very, very tied to each line, except for most likely Tech 2 and Tech 3.
Perhaps you haven't considered this as part of ship balancing, but the mass of supercapitals is very out of proportion of other ships, and fighting supercapitals is more often than often done by bumping the ship rather than shooting the ship. Do you see any scope to increase the mass of these ships or make them harder to bump as part of any balancing activities?
So are you talking about bumping ships, or are you talking about just a number of capitals? Because
if you look at the mineral components of a supercapital, they, and then at the mass, the supercapitals weigh a lot less than they should proportionally to other ships. And connected to that, often
okay.
with supercapitals in combat, what you do is you bump them all the time to stop them entering warp, to bump them out of shields, etc., which
yeah.
is probably not working quite as intended.
Yeah, I mean, bumping ships in general is a bit tricky, and we really want to have a look into it. I mean, the same thing when you go out of a sino and just everyone just boom, bumps everywhere. It's just not something we are happy with. Good look into it.
Are we going to see, as part of the ship lines rebalancing, like a skew towards races. So AMR ships are going to have more combat ships than support ships, and Minmatal have more attack ships than combat ships, or is it just going to be even Stevens across the races?
That's a very good question. Damn, this guy must read my mind. So yeah, depending on the race, you are going to have different ships of each line. So for example, if you look at Kaldari, they are most likely going to have more bombardment ships than the other races. If you look at Minmatal and Galente, they are most likely going to have more attack ships, and Amara could have like more combat ships. But nothing is preventing us to add some missing line in the other races at all. But at the moment, yeah, you have some flavor depending on the race, on the lines.
Are you going to be looking at the subsystems for T3s? They seem imbalanced in a lot of areas.
Yeah, definitely. That's tech free. Subsystems just need to be looked into, because at the moment we had to look at which kind of tech free ships are being used. You had like 65% of all tech free ships were Tengu, unsurprisingly. And then you're just like lucky. And even if you look at, I mean, we can't blame you for going for the ship that is the most efficient, because when you look at the tech free subsystem, I mean, there are not so many that are useful. So yeah, we definitely want to have a look into this, possibly try to tie this with the new modules that fit each of the subsystem lines. So for example, if you go for a tech-free ship, you could have like a first subsystem that is tied for the attack role, another subsystem set that is tied for the combat role, another for support, and so on. And then it will be easier to balance, it will be less complicated to balance in general. And yeah, that's something we want to do, if possible.
Yeah, my question is actually kind of a follow-up on his. It's specifically the fact that there's a ship that has a role for scouting, which is the Cobops frigates and stuff like that. And to an extent, cloaky bubble immune T3s can basically do the job better. And I was wondering if you had anything to address with that.
Yeah, I mean, that's a point we addressed before, is that ideally, in happy, happy pony land, tech-free ships are supposed to be less specialized than Tech 2. That's part of the plan, but the problem is if you just do that to the letter, then you possibly nerf Tech 3 ships into oblivion. So it's very difficult to just keep this balance going on, and that's why we are trying to make Tech 3 ships different in general, to keep a role for them without just making them obsolete. So for example, try to emphasize anything that helps make Tech 3 ships more like generic, more versatile. So for example, try to have like tech ships with swap subsystem at Starbase, for example, could be something that we look into. It's very difficult to have a look at this Tech 2 versus Tech 3 difference right now. But yeah, we want to have Tech 2 better to what they are doing, because they specialize in Tech 3.
What does the rebalancing mean for the non-player ships? Like, you've got your mission ships, if you're in faction warfare, you've got the NPC rats that all sit in the plex, and at the moment they're really unbalanced. You know, one race can solo, another can't, and stuff. What's the plans for reflecting these changes that you're talking about into the NPCs? Because one would assume if you're going to do it to the player ships, the NPCs would also match the similar sort of structure.
Yeah. NPCs just in general right now are just so easy to kill, it's not even funny. It's just like, yay, let's do some sleeper farming, and just, yeah, we know when the next wave is going to come on, and it's not even funny anymore. So yes, ideally, we want to make NPCs on par. It's just like player ships, not on par, but slightly below, so you still have a challenge. The general picture, the general idea is that since Eve is supposed to train you with PvP, the PvE is supposed to prepare you for that. So if I go, for example, my mission ship into low sec, I don't have to fit a PvE setup. I should fit a PvP setup and be able to kill NPCs with that, so when an evil player pirate comes into my mission, I'm not caught with my pants down. So ideally, yeah, we want to make NPCs a lot tougher, reduce the number, of course. We don't want to kill you too fast. But yeah.
We also have a look at the racial, e-war in this balancing. I mean, I guess that the ECM for Kaldari is, a racial thing, but it deactivates you completely. Whereas the Minmatar or the Amar or the Jalenti, they will reduce your effect, and you can counter it with a module that actually works.
So you're talking about having counter?
Because of Falcon, again, yeah.
Because of Falcon. Okay, ECM is a bit tricky, but the main problem with ECM is that it's just time-locking you. In general, is that you have to relock every time you just lose, every time you're just being jammed. So yeah, we're not happy with ECM in general, but it's again very tricky to do because we don't want to make it useless. If anything, we want to have a look at electronical warfare in general. We would like to have a look at dampeners that are not so much used right now. I mean, you use like Narazu or Lakazis for the warp scrambler range, mainly you don't use it that much for the dampening. And then, I mean, same for the Minmatar. I mean, target painters for EWA, seriously. So yeah. You definitely want to have a look into the different EWA models for the different factions. Any other questions?
Sorry. We talked yesterday also about the command ship and Tech 3 swap of command boni. At the moment, a Tech 3 command ship is not viable on grid.
Great.
It's just impossible to bring a command ship Tech 3 on grid. Are you considering to drop the command processor requirement for a command ship? I mean, I fit a Tech 3 command ship like a Loki. I should not be able to use command processors because command processors just mean I have to completely discard my tank. I have to slap coprocessors all over. Mm-hmm. Are you considering to make them viable when they are less powerful as a normal command ship to bring them on grid?
Okay, that's a specific change that we started to discuss at yesterday's roundtable, is that ideally we would like command ships to be on grid. Ideally, again, nothing is in stone right now. So if we bring them on grid, of course, there is this issue of tank and fitting command models. And we are looking into this. I mean, I can't really answer that right now. We know it's an issue. And that requires some design time to come up with solution and different, you know, feedback. But yeah. If we move the command ship on grid, we need to have a look into that.
Are you worried at all with defining roles for ships that you're going to tread on the toes of people who like to fit in an unconventional manner? People don't necessarily use ships in the way that have been intended, and so if you're applying a new role and saying this ship will be used for this purpose, mm-hmm. are you worried at all that people are going to have their gimmick ships nerfed?
I think what was your sentence?
Their gimmick ships nerfed, basically.
I didn't have tanker ships.
Yeah, so the ships that are used for an unintended purpose or for.
Okay. I mean, you already have that in game. You already have like setups that are just like used most of the time for the same ship. But yeah, you need definitely to be careful. As I said, at the moment, it's just like the ship lines are more of a guideline on how to use the ship and how for us to balance the ship as well. So you need to be very careful about how you apply that in practice because we don't want to kill the creativity. But remember, most of the time when a new shape or new changes come on, the first thing that happens is that you have like one or two guys coming up with a min-max setup and then everybody follows with the same setup, the same optimized setup for the same shape. So it's very difficult to break that as well.
My question is basically a follow-up on his. Is it on your mind that some people actually don't often fly in fleets and they like to prefer to fly the ships alone through space? And currently, a lot of the Tier 2 battle cruisers are used for that because you can like sort of fit them all around. You can fit tank, you can still have damage, and you can actually fight larger numbers than your own one ship effectively. Is it on your mind to make sure that when you rebalance the ship, people can still fly ships solo in PvP and that we're not out of a ship that we can actually effectively use against larger groups of people?
Mm-hmm. That's a very tricky question because no matter what we do, it's within the human nature to just blob and come in and you have like one ship in the belt, oh, it's a bait. But Yeah, I mean, we are trying to do that, but it's very difficult because you guys are very creative and very smart, and you always come with ways to just find corner issues of the system. But yeah, if possible, of course, we want to keep some solo going on. For example, the Galant with the blasters and your face was, I mean, designed for solo or small guns, so that's definitely something we want to keep going on, if possible. But regarding the tier 2 battlecruisers, I know I'm not going to be popular about saying that, but maybe they are doing things too well at the moment. Any other questions, please? Okay, then let's call it today. Thank you all for coming. I hope I will see you at the roundtables. I think it's a Saturday at 2, so see you there. Thanks a lot.